Artists Speak Out on BCTV is supported by Lucille DiGiamberardino.
Good evening, everyone, and welcome to Artists Speak Out. I have a woman here that I'm going to say I'm in love with her. I'm in love with her food. I'm in love with her artistry. And her name, I'm going to say the last name, is Martha Cavarretta. And she is here today to talk to you about her work in the food industry. She is an executive chef. That's what I just said, executive chef. So Martha, talk to me, honey. Tell me, we were talking a little bit outside. First of all, give me a little bit about your background. What's your ethnicity?
First, I'd like to thank you for having me on your show.
Oh. I love you. What are you talking about? This is going to be fun. Hold on to your, like I said. Never mind. So,
well, I am of Dominican descent.
Okay.
Yes, I am of Dominican descent.
Okay.
And grew up in Brooklyn, New York City.
Yeah.
Most of my career before I came to Pennsylvania was in Manhattan, New York City, mainly under 14th Street.
I'm going to tell you something. When I first met you, of course, now say where you work. Where is your place of work?
Saucony Creek, Franklin Train Station in Reading.
Okay, so I sat down, and I love to eat. I love it. So I sat down, and I ate this food, and I salivated. Okay? And then I said, who's the chef? And then when I heard it was a woman, well, then I kicked my heels up. So let me ask you, you gave me a little bit when we were out in the lobby. You talked about your journey and your father. See if you can give the viewers an idea of how did you become an executive chef?
Well, it wasn't my original goal in life. I wanted to be a designer. Mm-hmm. I knew how to sew already because I come from a long line of women, dressmakers and pattern makers and all of that. And I just realized that I'm not the next, you know, big designer like some of those out there,
right?
So I decided to go into, like I was saying, to use stenography.
Now, can you imagine? Please, audience, okay? A stenographer, this one over here. So then Dada said,
I went to my dad one day, and I'm cooking for him. I've always, you know, I grew up on my watching my grandmother cook and everybody cook, and food is like the center of everything. The kitchen is where you go to hang out, when you go to somebody's house.
Yep.
You're in the kitchen.
Yep.
So I'm always in the kitchen. I grew up in the kitchen, so I know how to cook. I could get around a kitchen at this point of my life. My dad says, what did you change to? And I says, stenography. He goes, what are you, crazy? You're not going to be able to do it.
You're going to, like I said, you're going to hang yourself in the shower.
Right. And he said, you got to go to culinary school. You are a great cook. I says, you know what? I always followed, after I was older, I followed his direction. You know what I mean?
I
As
do.
A teenager.
I know.
And all that, I was rebellious,
like
most kids, but you know.
Especially women.
Women.
And
exactly. So, boom, I says, okay. And I did that.
Yeah. Now, I want you to tell everyone, before we show your food and talk a little more.
Right.
Tell me who you then studied with and how did you get into that particular restaurant? Mm.
So, the last 6 months before you get your culinary degree, you have to choose who you like, what restaurant you'd like to work in to extern. So you learn and you get credits while you're in culinary school. Mm-hmm. So I chose one of the best, John George.
Why not? Michelin.
Michelin.
There you go. Why
Michelin
go to
chef.
The top?
Yep. Yes.
Yep.
And I went there.
Tell them what you mean.
I went for the interview.
Yeah.
And I was hired right there. I only worked half a day as an extern. Mm-hmm. I got a job halfway through my first day as an entremontier because the executive chef said, make me a French omelet.
Very different.
I made it in a minute and a half perfectly. Mm-hmm. And he said, you got a job? I need an entremontier. So I hopped through prepping. I hopped through salad. I hopped through every single bottom station straight onto the line as an entremontier.
Fantastic.
And I went up from there.
Brava. So I guess another thing is, as you went through that, and we talked a little bit about being women in our field.
Oh.
You had, I'm sure, there's lots of men at that time in the kitchen. How did it go?
In those years, it was 99% men. At that time, it was me and another girl who was prep and salad station.
Right.
Because that's
always
what women could do.
That's right.
So it's all men. Mm-hmm. And they just mess with you and mess with you. Mm-hmm. And I just said, you know what? My dad told me, he says, you mess with them back.
Mm-hmm.
I says, okay. So I became the dirtiest foul mouth cook, line cook that there was. They were like, oh, we can't mess with her.
Well,
can we curse?
Well, I don't know. No, we're not allowed to.
Oh, we're not allowed to. Okay. No cursing.
No cursing.
This is a family show.
We'll try. We'll try to behave, okay? But you did a good job. You didn't let it come out.
Right there, I set my goal.
But, you know, that's the thing. I mean, you set the goal and you come at something in the way that if you're going to go for it, you're going to go big. And if you're also going to have on the way some trials and tribulations, you face them.
That's right.
Okay?
That's right.
And you call it out. You meet them at that same level.
That's right.
And I understand.
Yes.
So now I'm going to bring you to where you are today.
Mm-hmm.
And now in Berks County, I'm grateful that I came back to retire to be around the people that I love. But there's not that many women chefs in Berks County, is there?
I don't think so. I mean, no, I don't know of any that I would. Oh! Judy.
Yeah.
I think that's it. Mm-hmm. Right?
Yeah. And I think out in Pottstown there's Gracie, too.
Gracie.
Grace 21st.
Oh, that's right.
Yeah.
That's
and
right.
And that's it out of all of these restaurants.
Yes.
That I know of.
Right.
Okay.
There might be some cooks out there.
Yeah.
But not executive chefs.
No.
You know.
No.
The top of the totem
the
pole.
The top. That's right. That's right. And you're a mama.
I am.
So
I
you
am.
Have three.
Three wonderful children.
Okay. How old again?
24, mm-hmm. 19, and 10.
Oh, my God. I got to say this quick before we segue to your food. On Sunday, I performed there, and I went back to his room. He has his own little room.
Yes.
And I said, your mom is very, very busy. And he goes, I gathered that. And I was just like, oh, my God, I'm loving this kid. So anyway, so now let's look at your food. Let's see what you got. I grabbed as much as I could on.
Oh, okay.
Okay, so tell me what that is. Do you know?
That is a cauliflower flatbread.
Ah.
So it's roasted cauliflower.
Uh-huh.
And there's refried beans on the fresh flatbread because it's a scratch kitchen.
Okay.
Every single item in my kitchen is freshly made.
Right.
Scratch kitchen.
Right.
It has a vegan aioli on it.
Wow.
And some red slaw and, of course, garnish of parsley.
Oh, my God. That's beautiful.
And we make the flatbreads.
Yeah.
With our beer.
Yeah, cool.
Those are made with our Stonefly, one of our flagship
beers. My mouth
beers.
Is starting to water
already. It's very good. It's okay. A vegan dish.
Yeah, well, there you go. And now let's look at the next one. Mm.
Ah, those are curry mussels.
Mm-hmm.
So this is a Thai-inspired dish.
Mm-hmm.
So the sauce is a yellow curry.
Yeah.
Done in a Thai form, mm-hmm. Little spicy, not too spicy. I find that a lot of people here don't like to be so, you know, they don't like that flavor, that crazy spice.
Yeah.
Some beautiful crusty French boule.
Yeah. And look at the color. See, what I love about your food is the color and the shininess of it.
Thank you.
Because that brings you into, I mean, you don't just eat with your mouth. You eat with the senses.
Definitely.
You know, the smells, everything.
Yep. Starts with the eyes.
Mm-hmm.
Then the smell.
Pretty. Next. Let's look at the next one. Okay, let's bring that forward if we could, if that's possible. I don't know. Yes, thank you so much, Joan. Yeah, there you go.
This was a surf and turf. Mm-hmm. So it was Italian sausage mm-hmm. with smoked lobster. I smoked the lobster outside with hickory chips. And I have a meat sauce, which covers, which is what these Italian sausage are. And so that's a surf and turf that I actually put out this Valentine's Day.
That is
and those really flowers are edible.
Yeah. Yeah.
All my bread comes from Philly unless I make it myself.
Well, I was going to talk to you about the bread.
Oh, yeah.
Okay. So there you go. Because bread is so important.
It's major.
Yeah.
Major.
Yeah. And you can always tell a restaurant by its bread, even before you eat.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Oh, I always like, okay, what's this?
Yes, 100%. 100%.
Let's look at the next one. I think I've got about six of them. So, and then we'll go back to you. Okay, what's this one?
This is the roasted beet salad. And it's laying over my fresh ricotta that I make in-house. And it has shaved Parmesan. Roasted candy cane beets. The pecans are roasted with beer and sugar mostly. Sort of a caramel flavor to them.
Yeah.
Some arugula. And this is a balsamic reduction that I make in-house.
Oh, my God.
It's not bought, people.
Yeah, there you go. We didn't go to whatever it is.
Right.
And get it.
Right.
Yeah. And let's look at the next one.
Okay. Oh.
Tell me what this one is.
This is popular. This is my salmon fish taco.
Okay.
Now, this was inspired 3 years ago. A guest came in and sent a message to me in the kitchen. Can you ask the chef if she could make me a shrimp or a fish taco?
Okay.
So at that time, I says, you know what? Tell him I will.
Aw.
So I cooked up a batter. I made a batter with one of our beers, of course, Saucony beer. Mostly everything has our Saucony beer in it. And I created fish tacos for him. I took, this is what I call slamming slaw.
Okay.
Which is a red slaw. It is a chipotle aioli. Made everything in-house, of course, dressed with, topped with scallions. These are tortillas that come from right here on West 6th Street.
Nice.
So they're local. They make them fresh there. And this is what it is. So when he had that, he went crazy.
I bet.
So I says, okay, let's put it on the menu.
Yeah, why not? Now that you created it.
Yes, yes.
Yeah. Let's try the next one.
Oh, those are my smoked ribs. I smoke them outside, and I make a barbecue sauce with our Saucony beer stout, our stout.
I bet you people go nuts about that,
because
ribs are very big.
Those are baby backs, and they come from, I also believe in sustainability.
Yes.
So nothing is coming from a kill place.
Yes.
So this is coming from a farm in here in Hershey, Pennsylvania.
Yes. Yes, because you have to go to see how they're slaughtered. You really do.
Yes.
I know.
Yes.
I know. Okay, next. And how they're slaughtered.
And how they're treated.
That's exactly right. Oh, look at this one.
Let me see.
See if we get this one.
Oh. Oh, okay. This is my carnitas flatbread.
Okay.
So it inspired me to, I was eating carnita tacos. And I says, you know what? I'm going to do this on a flatbread.
Yeah. Yeah.
So I made some pulled pork with our beer, and I'm not going to give you all the ingredients, you know, I braised that and then pulled it apart. I put it on the flatbread with its juices.
Oh, yeah.
And then that's an avocado salsa.
Oh, I love that.
That I created.
And how beautiful that green is.
Thank you.
Oh, my God.
Yes.
Yeah.
That's the lemon.
And I, is that
you
it?
Need lemon.
Uh-huh.
Yes. If you want stuff to stay green.
That's gorgeous.
Okay. Thank you.
Let's look at the next one, if there is another one, or is that it? No, we're good.
Okay.
Okay. Now, okay, audience, guess what? I'm salivating. So. I have to clean my throat here a little bit. So, okay. So, how long have you been in Berks County at this point?
I purchased my home in 2016.
Okay.
And it needed a lot of remodeling. So, I stayed in New York while it was being remodeled. Well, not totally remodeled, because you're never done with these old homes.
That's right.
So I'm in Center Park.
Okay.
So I'm in one of these old homes,
oh,
right?
Oh, beautiful.
I love it there.
Oh, it's
wonderful. I love it there. So you're never done. I made it livable, let's say.
Let's say.
Right?
So it's a work in progress.
It's a work in progress. I'm getting there, but, you know.
Yeah.
So 2016, 2 years while I was fixing it up, let's say. And then in 2018, I finally came over.
Okay. So then did you come over because you were going to be working there, or did you get that job?
No.
So how did
I actually opened, this is the third restaurant I opened.
Ah.
I opened a restaurant. It didn't go well.
Uh-huh. Okay.
So, I mean, I don't like saying it didn't go well because it wasn't my fault.
But It's okay. A lot
so
of
it closed it down.
Work. Okay.
So I started looking for employment.
Mm-hmm.
It's, you know, it's not easy
Mm-mm.
when you're at the top
Mm-hmm.
of your game
Mm-hmm.
to find a job.
Mm-hmm.
It's easy for the middle, right?
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
So it took me a little time, but I interviewed at another place that was opening. They hired a male
Mm-hmm.
instead of me, even
Okay.
though I gave them,
Uh-huh.
you know what I gave them.
I know it.
My
they,
art.
I know.
And I interviewed to open Franklin Train Station.
Okay.
And 5 interviews later,
right?
After I cooked for them,
uh-huh.
they were like, when
You're
can
on.
You start? You're
yeah.
on, you're opening
yeah.
this
yeah.
restaurant.
One thing I love about that restaurant, well, besides the fact of it being in the Reading Train Station,
yes.
okay, and a historic building, but what I love about it is, we talked about this earlier, there is, it's like a family,
Mm-hmm.
okay?
Definitely.
It's, I'm not even talking about the owners, although they're a family, most of them too.
They are.
But the staff, everything, you feel as if you're at home
yes.
in a nice restaurant.
Yes.
Okay, so that you all the people, the kitchen people, the wait people, everybody is
yes.
definitely loves each other.
Yes, we do.
And we talked about this before. Why do I sing? Why do I do this TV
yes.
show? Because I want to give joy to people and just make everybody laugh and smile.
110%.
Your philosophy is similar.
Yes.
What when you cook, when you start to bring your creations out, What goes on inside of you as an artist? What is it you're trying to express? You talk.
I'm trying to make them smile.
Mm.
You know?
Mm-hmm.
Feel, oh my goodness, this is, you know, someone put effort into making me feel happy.
Mm-hmm.
And being at my place and being happy, and just that's what I imagine.
Mm-hmm.
Is this, when I'm creating something, I automatically, sometimes I don't even taste what I'm creating, but I know it's going to taste good, and I definitely try to meet everyone's palate.
Okay.
I try to make everyone happy.
Yes.
My menu is so versatile,
yes.
from vegan to gluten-free to,
yes.
you know, whatever you want.
Mm-hmm.
It's on my menu.
Yeah, I noticed that.
So yeah.
I'm always happy because I'm a pescatarian now. I used to be a vegetarian.
Yes.
I was never a vegan. I couldn't spend the amount of time in my life to do that.
It's hard.
I respect it.
Yes.
But it's not easy.
It's a lifestyle.
It's a lifestyle. So, but you, I have noticed that there is a variety that is for all palates.
Yes.
And then I guess the next question I want to ask you, I want to talk about people and palates. So say we talked earlier about one of the things that you showed where you don't make it too spicy, but there is a spice.
Yes.
So, and again, you have to think about where you live and what people's tastes are like.
Exactly.
So when you're, I need to ask you more about your artistry. When you're doing this, and you said you don't always taste it, but you know by how you're putting it together, this masterpiece, okay, that this is going to taste a certain way.
Yes.
What goes on for you? What's internal for you as you're creating a dish and then producing it?
You know, it has to be my eyes.
Uh-huh.
I take inspiration
mm-hmm.
from everywhere.
Mm-hmm.
Things I hear, see, taste,
mm-hmm.
and I see things sometimes, And I'm like, oh, I got to use this. I got to do this. So it's like women will go out and we'll buy a pair of shoes.
Right.
Right? And nothing else goes with these shoes. So you have to go out and find the outfit for these shoes. Right? The same idea. Right? I'll taste something, or I'll think about something, or something comes to my brain. I'm like, I got to use that.
Oh.
It's I'm buying those pair of shoes, but I have no outfit.
Uh-huh.
And then I start boom, 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 putting stuff together.
And that's what makes you excited, I'm sure.
Exactly. Once I've created
that,
it
gives you a high.
I'm like, yes, they're gonna love this.
Well, I was putting these shoes.
Uh-huh.
And I thought, I've got to get a skirt to go with these shoes.
Right, right. That's how we are.
It's the truth.
Yes.
You know, now, of course, when I first came and met you, I fell in love with you right away.
Thank you. I fell in love with you, too.
Well, thank you. Because we have a sisterhood that
yes.
I feel. And I feel like we could just sit and talk forever and mm-hmm. laugh and just mm-hmm. share crazy, wonderful, tragic events in our lives.
Yes. Okay. Strong women.
Yes. There you go. There you go. There you go, baby. And so let me ask you this. Now, once you get that out, how does it feel when you put your dish out? Because the dish is with you, right?
Mm-hmm.
So it's sort of like a visual artist who's
yes.
painting or doing whatever.
Yes.
This dish is with you, and then you put it out. How do you feel?
Amazing.
Mm-hmm. Okay, so tell me about
my that. My first taste testers, let's say, yeah. are my staff.
Uh-huh.
You know, my family,
because
I consider everyone in the restaurant my family.
Right.
So they're the first ones to taste. Kitchen staff, of course, first.
Yep.
My sous chef plays a big role.
Okay, talk to me about that.
He has an amazing palate.
Mm.
So sometimes I love a little too much salt.
Mm-hmm.
And he's the one who sort of holds me back.
Yes.
You know, on the salt.
Yes.
But when I put out a dish, you shouldn't need salt and pepper.
Right, right.
It's absolutely perfect the way you need it. You don't need anything
That's
else,
right.
right?
That's right.
So he helps me in a lot. Sometimes I'll come up with something. And I'll say, what can I put with this? What can I do? And he'll start machining his brain. So he's a big part of who I am.
Yeah, yeah. So how did you find this sous chef?
He's actually my husband.
There's a marriage going on. But see, the thing is, some people do, and they're possibly not a cook or a chef or
mm-hmm.
an executive chef,
mm-hmm.
but they have a palate. And I know I have one. So it's like, it's wonderful when you actually have, when you're in your space, your studio,
mm-hmm.
your kitchen,
mm-hmm.
to have somebody that is your husband, but who loves you, but also has an educated palate.
Yes. Yes.
And the two of you can then work together.
Yes.
You know, and I think that's absolutely beautiful.
Yes.
Oh,
he was
God.
My protege for years until he finally made it to sous chef.
Wow, how cool is that?
Yes.
And that brings tears to my eyes.
Aw.
Because that is so beautiful.
Thank you.
It is a romance that comes out in the food.
Yes.
And then the romance comes to our table.
Yes.
Is that what I'm, you know what I'm saying?
110%.
Okay. I'm Italian, excuse me, I get it.
Yeah. It is a big part of who I am in the kitchen.
Yeah, exactly.
I mean, yeah.
And he supports you and he loves you.
110%.
Sous chef is the most important thing, I think, when you're in the kitchen and you're an executive chef.
Oh,
and
yes.
That relationship is imperative.
Yes.
Yeah, that's it.
Yes.
So now let me ask you this. Now, I also said to you when I met two of your kids.
Yes.
Yeah. And this is how I'm going to close, really, but I want to ask
Aww.
You. When, besides admiring your artistry and tasting your wonderful food, when I actually had that ability to meet your children and saw how balanced these kids are and how open and free they are, because I was actually in the bouncy castle with your little son, and he said to me, I can't get a ball into a basket. I said, me neither, but I can dance. So we had a great time.
He's pretty awesome. He's a great kid.
You cultivated that in them, and that's another success besides being who you are and what work you do.
Right.
Okay, so you're a good mama.
Well, if you're good to yourself, you're good to everyone else around you.
Right.
So I try to always be happy and keep myself motivated and inspire. I'd like to inspire everything around me.
Yeah.
So I think that's where it comes from.
I know. And now let me ask you this. If I just gave you this question, what gives you joy? It doesn't have to be about your work. It could be. In other words, just what gives you joy?
Wow. I didn't know. I wasn't ready for that one.
Yeah. Zingy.
I think what gives me joy is knowing. No, that wouldn't be it. It has to be
something that you feel.
You know, I don't want to be cliche.
Go ahead.
So that's why I'm overthinking this.
Yeah, I can feel it.
But it's my children that give me joy. They give me joy. Like, you know, they make me laugh. They make me smile. Mm-hmm. Watching them be successful. Mm-hmm. Goals and everything that they do, that gives me joy.
Yeah.
You know, and a lot of people say my kids give me joy, but.
You live within their spirit. I see it. One thing I know is that I'm very good at seeing things, and that has a lot to do with life experiences.
Yes.
Okay? So, and what I see in you is that there is you have such joy towards your children and the love that you have to let them be who they want to be.
Yes, exactly.
And let them fly.
Yes, fly, Robin, fly.
Uh-huh.
I can't sing like you, girl.
But you did it.
I know the words.
Well, as you can see, we are at our close, and it was so quick. So I really, number one, bow to you as you bow to me.
Oh, I do.
And I love you.
I love you, too.
And I'm so glad that somehow in the process of being here, I found you.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
Thank you so much. That was really sweet.
Thanks, honey. I mean it.
I love what I do.
I know you do.
But
and
my
I
children
love what you
bring
do, too. So anyway, I want to say to the audience, peace with you and that we love you. Ciao.
Ciao.
Artists Speak Out on BCTV is supported by Lucille DiGiamberardino.